American Legion Post 86, interview of Claude McConnell. Wartime unit, what was the name of your unit that you served in?
458th Bomb Group in Norwich, England in 1944, April 44 till 45, June the 6th, 1945.
Yeah. A campaign awards that you received.
I did not ask for them, and I wasn't interested in campaign awards. Okay. I wanted to battle over.
Yeah.
I volunteered, and they took me before graduation in high school in 1943. So I was accepted for flight engineer on bombers, and we were flying four-engine B-24 Liberators during my period of time at training at Keesler Field, and also when I was assigned to a crew that we worked with, that we flew with, I flew with out in Colorado. We were flying out of Norwich, England, and bombing. And then we were assigned during a period of time to fly fuel to Patton, five gas hauls to Patton. But the most one that really was the most definite one and more terrible things happened was to Berlin, 960 miles, but we had a bomb run, a 95 mile bomb run over Berlin at 19,000 feet. And we were leading 25 planes, and we were lead crew that day. And we, on the way, on the 95-mile bomb run, had to feather number two engine because it had a runaway prop. That's when it started. You know, then you had to feather it, and so everything was perfect. We feathered it, and when we got right over, I went back and pulled pins on six 1,000-pound bombs, and the bombardier was ready to, they were all ready to go. And well, I got back in my top turret because I was flying top turret that day, and the radio operator had to be on his station since we were lead plane. Mm-hmm. And I saw the bomb burst. I felt the bomb burst. The right wing went up, and suddenly I looked out and the prop was spinning, chewing back into the wing of my right wing of the airplane. And all of a sudden, I didn't hear anything because we were up there at 19,000 feet. And all of a sudden, I saw a flash of light down below me. And I came out of my turret and saw that it was electric cord and that had this prop broke off and came across to the co-pilot's foot of the nose of the plane, and it cut his foot enough that the blood was coming out, but not to the extent that he needed to be attention at that time. Mm-hmm. And all of a sudden, I felt, when I got the fire extinguisher and extinguished the fire and pulled the cable away from the fuselage, and my feet were in 2 to 3 inches of hydraulic fluid because this prop cut a 4x7 foot gash in our right side of our nose of our plane. Between the navigator and the pilots. It was open, a 4 by 7 foot gash. And I tried to crimp the pipe of the hydraulic line pipe, but it was so stiff that I couldn't get it all the way up bent. And all that hydraulic fluid in the bottom. So I went up on the flight deck after I got everything squelched there of the fire, and the hydraulic fluid wasn't coming anymore. The pilot says, "Claude, get everybody." He came out of his seat, he turned it over to the pilot, co-pilot, and we were flying, he was flying, trying to get it down so the others could go above us and get it out of the direction of the other planes coming up behind us. So he said, "Claude, I want to get everybody ready, and I'm going to ring the bailout bell, and I want you to make sure everybody's out." I said, "I'm not going out." And he says, "Why?" I said, "Because my parachute is saturated with hydraulic fluid, and I know it won't develop, I mean, or inflate, and I wouldn't be able, I'd be dead, of course." I wasn't going to go. And I'll fly it back to the channel if you guys going to go out. But he says, "No, nobody's going out. Well, you and I will take it down." So I went back to knowing that the number two engine's out, number three is out. I started the auxiliary electrical system, putt-putt we call it, and that got the instruments back up, because when this prop 4 by 7 foot gash was across our nose, and the navigator told me later that he could see the earth right in front of him. And the pilot said to me, "Claude," when he said, "we're taking it down." And I was thinking about getting everything ready, the auxiliary power. He says, "Get the navigator to give us a heading," because they had lost their instruments, the compass and everything. And the auxiliary unit brought it back up. He says, "Get the navigator, give us a heading." I went down there. I said, "I think it was sucked out of the 4 by 7 foot gash in the nose." And he said, "Oh my God." And the navigator had been out, had that problem before. And so he wasn't going to be jumping out. Mm-hmm. So he told us the name on the table, and I pulled him across the tape, the hole, got him up on the deck. And I said, "Alan, pilot needs a heading." And he says, I don't have my maps. He said, "I don't have the maps." So I said, "Where are they?" He said, "I think they went out to that hole." I went down and found the maps down on the bottom of the feet, or on the bottom of the plane. Took them back up there and got them. I opened up, and he says to Claude, I can't see. Okay. And two P-51s came up on our wingtips. One on each wingtip. And the pilot somehow communicated with the fighter planes, and they took us back down to Brussels, Belgium. 250 miles we had to make it. So I kept on transferring the fuel out of two into one, three into four, and that kept us flying. And when we approached, I had to tell them, going through the Bombay, and Bombay doors open, you couldn't close them because I didn't have any hydraulic fluid, and didn't have landing gears, you couldn't work up our landing gear, had to crank the landing gear down. And also went back to the back and had them throw out everything that was not attached that they can get rid of flex suits so they can fly, you know, the plane
sure.
less weight. And the bomb bay door being open, that's more drag. See, and that's the reason it was really using up our fuel trying this too, trying to keep that plane going. And I said, get a parachute. Happened to, I told him, throw it out the window. The window wouldn't be up like that. And they left the windows up because they could get out in case they had to really bail out if he ring the bailout bell.
Mm-hmm.
But at any rate, all the guns went out, helmets and everything that they can get a hold of, ammunition. And we were approaching the airfield, and I don't know how communication I got the idea of flying, cranking down the landing gear and had to kick out the nose wheel because a co-pilot came by. He says, Claude, where's the latch on it? I says, the latch is locked on the top. And he went out, and I went up behind him, and the nose wheel went out. I had the landing gear cranked down because that was approach. I didn't want to, and I was firing red flares. And the plane, I know the wheels are down, but I didn't know they were locked. But because it stopped. And there was another, there were two bombardiers with us. One that was visible bombing, the other one in case that it was cloudy, target cloudy, he was on the flight deck with me. And so I was cranking down the thing, and he came up and he helped me. And my feet were hydraulic fluid on my boots, flight boots. I was standing on the edge of this metal where you get on the catwalk and walk all the way through the bomb bay back to the tail. But that hydraulic fluid, my boots slipped. He grabbed me by the harness and pulled me back up. And that's on the way that I was saved, not going out without a parachute.
Yeah.
But we got the wheels down, and I made the co-pilot was there, and he helped. I mean, he actually got the thing, the nose wheel, out, and I saw that it was Dylan because I met him behind him, and I said, "Is it locked?" He says, it looked like it was locked. So he went back to his position, and I went back and made sure that my generator is still running in the putt-putt to keep the instruments panel the present. And as I fired those red flares, that meant I had injury on board. Well, the co-pilot had that blood coming out of his boot or the leg, and it wasn't that bad. But it went right on in, and when we touched down, the number four engine quit, ran out of gas. Number one engine was still running, and the prop, and they threw the parachute out the left window, and that was our brakes. We didn't have any brakes, didn't have any added quarter flaps on landing. Well, we went right in, and two P-51s took off. The pilot touched down at Brussels, Belgium, that I was standing up in between them. I had a hatch that I could open up and I could stand up. And I was trying to get people back from a fence. They had a big wire fence, and they were all looking, watching us come in. And I don't know why they were, they had coats on that are horse, from the horse skins. Yeah. and different colors of horse hide.
And you were concerned the plane was going to hit that fence?
Yeah, and I thought it was going to go right through that fence, because when the parachute was deployed, it carried, it was pulling, because that was a lot of weight, you know, big plane like that. And we got it off the runway and went down into the earth a little bit because it had been wet, you know, moisture.
Uh-huh.
But they were staying out there. And I think we stopped about twice as the distance from here to that wall from them.
Yeah.
Yeah, I was afraid we were going to go right through that iron fence. And that was at 5 o'clock or 5:30 in the afternoon. And we had left, well, we got up at 2 o'clock that morning to get ready and go to Berlin. And by all that action, it was 5 or 5:30, and everybody jumped out of their plane and kissed the ground, it seemed. And I took the picture of our plane, and they said, oh, take it this way. And I said, no, I want to get that gash as much as the engines that I could see, and that one torn up. And I said, can you get us a... We haven't had anything since breakfast, you know, and that was 5 o'clock from 2 o'clock when they got us up that morning. And he said, yeah, I can take you, I think I can take four of you. So four, and he was the driver into Brussels, Belgium. It was 7 miles airfield. We had dinner, and I ordered a steak. And the guy, one of the gunners, said to me, hell, McConnell, that's not a steak. I said, a steak tonight. It was horse meat.
It was horse meat.
Hell, McConnell, that's horse meat. It's not a steak. And they said, oh, aren't you going to, you know, try to get a message? Oh, so you get a star or some
citation?
Yeah. And I said, I'm not interested. The pilot can do his job, getting away, of saving 10 men's lives.
Mm-hmm.
But I think that transferring that fuel that got us away from Berlin and not going out, I think that's the thing that God put in my heart and my training back at Keesler Field and mechanical parts of the operation of the airplane, because I enjoy working with a plane.
That's quite a story.
Yeah.
Well, it's quite an experience,
yes,
Claude. You know, I heard some of this before when you presented it to the Post 86, and I've thought about it many times.
You've really had this on your mind a long time.
Yeah. Well, yeah. How many missions? I know it's on the...
32 missions and 5 gas hulls. But hell, when they load that thing up, somebody's got to take it. So I didn't volunteer for every mission, but I went on every mission this time.